This is Martin Smith for the Bay Sessions in Stourbridge with Rick Wakeman. We're going to be talking about some unique concerts he's got coming up, which will be his only ones in the UK in 2013, and plenty more besides. So, how you doing, Rick?
Ow! Afternoon, Rick. Thanks for
good afternoon, sir.
Tripping up to Stourbridge to come and pay us a visit, and welcome. This is being recorded just ahead of some big gigs that you've got coming up, and your only gigs in the UK
for
2013. Could you tell us a little bit about the gigs and what they're going to involve, please? Because they're quite special, aren't they?
They are quite special. They've turned into something special by accident, really. Started almost a year ago to the day, and I was asked by the organisers of the Gloucester Mystery Plays. They had the idea of having a huge pageant at a rugby ground in Gloucester with the orchestra and choir doing King Arthur, which was the original plan, which would require a lot of new music, a lot of rewriting, a lot of it. And I thought that could be really, really excellent. So we started working on it, and everything was going really good, and a lot of people were very interested in what we were going to do. And then it came up to Christmas, and there appeared to be a bit of a problem between the organisers and the rugby ground. I think basically at the end of the day, it came into sort of early January, late January, and it sort of appeared that for whatever reason, it wasn't going to work. They couldn't reach an agreement on how it was going to happen. And I had a meeting with the organisers, and they said, well, we can't get the rugby ground. It's a shame, really, because a lot of people are interested in what you were going to do. A lot of interest from abroad as well, because we put stuff up on the website and whatever. And I said, well, it's a shame not to do anything, because, I mean, I know actually there's an awful lot of people, a lot of friends of mine, that at least a couple of hundred are coming from America that have booked hotels already. They booked one in advance. And I said, I'm not going to be very popular because they know where I live, and they'll probably come down and burn my house down. So I said, look, it'd be nice to do something. So we looked around, and I said, you're not going to get an outdoor venue now. It's just not going to be able, you know, to be sorted
in short
notice in Gloucester. You're not going to get it. So see if you can find an indoor venue that will suit. There's not many big indoor venues in the area, but they came out and said, do you know the Centaur in Cheltenham at the racecourse? I said, I do. I know the racecourse very well as well. I said, yeah, that would work well. I said, so if we can do a couple of nights there, we can get the orchestra. But then, of course, it was a matter of what do you do? And I said, well, you know, we can't do, obviously, because of the big pageant thing, of what we originally planned to do. That's just not going to be possible. I do another show with an orchestra, which is one with a piano and an orchestra. And I said, that's a possibility, but I think it should be something different. I have done that once in the UK before, and I've done it all over Europe and in South America. And I said, it does work, but what would be really nice would be to do something a bit special, as there's so many people coming from, you know, from abroad. So I sat and had a chat with the band, and they said, well, we could do excerpts from bits and pieces, and I said, well, yeah, that might work. And I spoke to Guy Prothero, who's my conductor and orchestrator, and he said, well, what we could do, we could take the orchestral scores that we use for what we call the piano and orchestra show, adapt them, add some bits and pieces, so it becomes totally different. The band will have to learn the new arrangements of the new, and then we can put it together, so it would be a mixture of probably the best known music of what you've done for the people who know you, which would be a large chunks of Journey to the Centre of the Earth. It's about 30 odd minutes worth of that. Then there's about 30 minutes worth of King Arthur that we do. There's a couple of the Six Wives pieces that we do in different ways. We do Starship Trooper with the orchestra, which is unusual. There's bits like Dance of a Thousand Lights. There's quite a lot that we've thrown in that we've never actually done before. I spoke to the band about it, and they were all up for it. They were a little shocked when I gave them a copy of the piano orchestra, because it's completely different versions from the way we play it as a band. So one of the hardest things for them was to unlearn what they already know, to try and learn the new bits. But it worked really, really well. It'll be the only time it'll ever be done. It'll never be done again because it's too complicated. And secondly, it's very expensive to do. But it's just nice to know that the concerts will be something incredibly special. They're the only ones this year in the UK, the only big concerts. And I can't honestly ever see it happening again. It might, I suppose, possibly happen somewhere abroad if somebody wanted it. But the big problem you've got of doing these kind of shows abroad is the shipping of the equipment, shipping of the gear, shipping of the band and everything. So even if they supply the orchestra and the choir, it costs a fortune to get out there and start all the rehearsals and do all the bits and pieces. So I honestly, I can't see it ever being done again, so I'm really looking forward to it, because it'll be really, really quite special.
Mm-hmm. You've been noted, I think, throughout your career in terms of making some big investments in big shows and
losing money.
Well, yeah. Big investments.
Big investments.
They can go up as well as down. Of
well,
course.
I've always believed in if you're going to do something, do it properly. I mean, people had sort of said I was nuts doing King Arthur on Ice at Wembley. And we sold out. We did three nights. There was 9,000 people, which is all we could get in. So it was 27,000 people. We did three nights. I think all in all, there was just over 300 people in the cast, with ice skaters, orchestras, choirs, bands, and whatever. And yeah, it lost money, but it had to lose money. We knew it was going to lose money, and everybody said you're barking. I said, yeah, okay, that's fine. But that was the days when what you did live was your advertisement for the album. That's what you did. And on the back of that, the album did 12 million copies. Before we did Arthur on Ice, I think it had done about two. Mm-hmm. So, it's that's like saying to Coca-Cola, why do you spend so many millions on advertising? You know people are going to buy it. That's not actually strictly true. You've got to show people what it is that you do. And it was the same for Journey. Now, these concerts will be at best, well, they will. They'll make some money for the charity because they are charity performances. But from our side of things, they'll break even because that's all we sort of care about. And we know we've already broken even with the ticket sales that have gone. And then the charity hopefully will do well. But it is important to do something that's a bit special. I do like it that when we've got some fantastic supporters who come along and we've never, ever given them anything ordinary. Mm-hmm. And I think they would be disappointed if they got something ordinary. Mm-hmm. So it is going to be very different in every respect.
Do you think, Rick, that with the With the rise of the YouTube generation and the phenomenon that there is so much video and recorded visual material available, do you think that providing a unique experience like this is going to be in a live sort of context is something that's still important in music?
I think it's very important. I mean, you still get people who talk about concerts, whether it be anything from Pink Floyd's The Wall to a Yes show or a Joe show, they were there. They will still tell you about the time they were at that particular concert, how much they enjoyed it, the atmosphere. You get atmosphere at a live venue. With no disrespect, you don't get atmosphere on YouTube. But I've never heard anybody say, oh, I remember that, fantastic. I saw that YouTube, absolutely brilliant. They'll talk about the great concerts and things that they see. I still think that people genuinely really like the live experience. If you didn't have the live experience, you wouldn't have YouTube anyway.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, it's impossible, I suppose, in a way, to replicate actually being there, isn't it?
You can't. And most of YouTube is somebody who's held up a camera phone or something like that, or bits and pieces. The quality of sort of 95% of everything on YouTube is probably, how can I put this politely? Well, it's crap, really, isn't it? To be brilliant. I mean, we all watch it because it's great, little bits and pieces here and there. But you cannot beat actually being at an event, because the thing about a live event is you don't actually know what's going to happen. You're going to have some magic moments, and you might have a few sort of life belt moments. And it's being part of that whole atmosphere of not knowing. I mean, the people who come, they know they're going to hear the music that we do, but they're going to hear it in a different way than they ever heard it. They're going to hear different shortened versions of Journey, of Arthur, of Six Wives, plus other pieces, a few things that they won't expect, a few things that happen, and that's pretty unique. I think that's what I go to a show for.
To see something unique.
Yeah.
And logistically, it's a big production. You've got an orchestra of 80 or 90.
Something ridiculous, yeah.
And a large band.
You're not going to ask me to name them, are you?
And yeah. Phone numbers, if possible.
Yeah.
So what are the sort of logistical difficulties in putting on a production of that sort of scale?
This one is different in many ways because we're doing another show as well at Blackfriars in
a slightly
in
smaller.
Well, it's completely show. Different. It's mm-hmm. something completely different. I'll come on to that in a minute. The difficulty is, first of all the orchestral scores have got to go to the orchestra, who have to rehearse them prior to that. So my conductor will go down and he rehearses the orchestral parts with the orchestra. That's before any of that. My band have got copies of all the new arrangements, so they're working together and learning the bits and pieces and change, so they'll be ready. It's all part of the jigsaw that when you all come together, you haven't got to hang around for somebody to try and learn something to, because there isn't time to do that. My crew have already spent 6 days in putting various rigs, the keyboard bits and other things that are necessary, to bring along and to do. Now, how it's going to work is, I mentioned that there's another show as well. One of the things, because Gloucester Cathedral are all to do with the charity of various things, and originally it was going to be the Gloucester Mystery Players, and it was all going to be in Gloucester, we wanted to do something in Gloucester as well as Cheltenham. But it was a matter of finding somewhere to do it. One of the ideas we had was to use Gloucester Cathedral. It's on the Saturday, which is the 15th, I think. But that would mean that we would have to get in on the 14th to do something. We can't get in on the 14th because there already is an event going on at the 14th, which ironically I got invited to. It's a big Masonic dinner, and I got invited to it, and I went, can't you go somewhere else? And I'll come up to that. So that actually ruled that out. But they have another unique place there called Blackfriars, which is really quite small. It's like about 300 people it holds. And the organiser said, well, could you do something in there? And I said, we could do something completely different, perhaps. So I did a thing back in the, about 1992, something like that, with my second eldest son, Adam, who's now with Black Sabbath. And we did this thing called Wakeman with Wakeman. And it was really successful. People really liked it. He's a great, great player. And then I did in later years, I did something with my oldest boy, Oliver, who went out and played with Yes recently for a couple of years. And we did a couple of concerts and things together. That was really good. And my daughter, Gemma, my oldest daughter, Gemma, who's 30 now, we've recorded a few things together. She sang on a couple of albums. Great voice, great player too. We did the Amazing Grace DVD as well. And I thought, well, maybe if I could get one of them together, we could do another Wakeman with Wakeman. So I thought, well, I'll find out which one of them fancies doing it. So I sent an email to all of them. I said, if any of you fancy, just let me know. Well, they all came back and said, that'd be great. If we can work out the dates and everything to do it, that would be, if it all works for us, then we'd all like to do it. So we've ended up then with Wakeman, with Wakeman, with Wakeman and Wakeman. Don't ask me which one's which, because they all want top billing. I've told each one of them they're the first Wakeman, so Oliver thinks Wakeman with Wakeman, that's Oliver, and Adam also thinks the same, and so does Gemma. The only criteria they said was that they all wanted to have a microphone, not particularly to sing through, but so that they can say things about their dad, that's fair enough, I suppose.
Will you be speaking with the sound engineers to make sure that...
Well, I have told them I'm the one that's paying their checks at the end of the day. So anyway, we're just going to have a couple of keyboards. All the music we're playing, I don't think there's one piece that we're going to be playing that is replicated at the Cheltenham shows. So it's completely different, including some of their own stuff, because they've all had their own albums and things out. And they went on sale. They sold out the morning they went on sale, both those shows. We're doing a 6 o'clock show and a 9 o'clock show that night. Now, whilst that's going on, the orchestra will be rehearsing at the Centaur with my band, with the English Rock Ensemble, minus me. So they will be rehearsing with the orchestra while we're doing the Wakeman. They'll be rehearsing that. So that what happens then in the evening after we've finished, my keyboards go down and join the other additional keyboards that they've got of mine down at the center. They're rigged up overnight. First thing in the morning on the Sunday, we then rehearse again with the orchestra and choir, with the band, with me. And then we've got the first show that evening. And it actually works really well to... Somebody said, well, don't you get absolutely knackered doing the rehearsals and things as well on the day of the show? It actually works really well because any little areas that you're not that 100% sure of in your brain, they're there because you've literally just played them. Whereas the next day, they're bound to go wrong again, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And we did this recently. We did Journey to the Centre of the Earth down in Buenos Aires in November, December, in fact, last year. And we rehearsed on the day of the show with the orchestra and the choir, and then did the show in the evening. And it was really quite interesting because we were the opposite of being tired. The adrenaline was flying like crazy. And the little bits that always were a bit tricky went through as smooth as silk. And then when we did the show, we did two shows, we did the one the next day. That was great. So I actually quite like the idea of intense rehearsals on the day of the show, because everything's really fresh and raring to go.
Focused on
yeah, and then there's another show on the Monday. So it's the organisation. You're quite right. Going back to your original question, it is an awful lot involved. I've got two crews working because obviously one's got to work Black Friday and they join up, and the other one's got to work the centre and they work together. It's a nightmare for my keyboard tech because he's going to be flitting back between the two. But these guys are fantastic. They're the best in the business and they know exactly what they're doing. And I know the worst thing you could ever do to any of them is say, what are you doing? Because the answer is they'll turn around and say, we know what we're doing, do you?
Difficult as dad, but also as the leader of the band. How does that work? Are you tougher on them, or do you let them off a little bit?
I'm useless. I'm totally useless. The good thing is that they are all really good pros. They really are. They really they take everything very seriously. They care about what they do, and they want to do it well. So you don't have to sort of turn around and say, you haven't learned that, you haven't done that. Well, they're more likely to turn around to me and say, you haven't learned my piece right. That kind
of
thing.
Right, so they're a bit tough on you then?
Oh, they'll have a go at me. I've got six kids and they all play, they all do different things. The three that are missing, are missing for a reason, is my son Oscar, who's a... He's a good player. He's a good guitar player. He lives in Chile, and I said not keen on covering the fare back from Chile. I've got a son who lives in Switzerland, does a lot of electronic music. He's going to be there actually. He's coming over, and I've got a daughter in America, but she's just about to have my eighth grandchild, so she can't make it over. Actually, to have the four of us on stage, that won't happen again either, because the boys in particular are so busy, they just work all the time. So in all, it's going to be a really unique little period of time. immense amount of rehearsals before we even get down there, and there'll be an immense amount of eyes down looking, especially with the band and the orchestral stuff. But again, the band's been with me for years and years and years. I know that when they arrive, they'll really have learned everything that they want to learn, and they'll be adding an awful lot to it as well. Mm-hmm. So, and we love playing with orchestras, so you don't actually get the opportunity that often. So, and the Centaur, such a nice place.
The eye lines are something special about the visibility aspect for the audience.
It's really good at the Centaur. I mean, because it really was designed with wherever you sit, you can see, and you can hear, and you can't say that about too many places these days. So it's the first time I've played there, so I'm really looking forward to it.
And for anybody who can't get to the shows,
tough.
DVDs, albums around the projects. What's coming up on that school?
It's possible that we may record the Centaur. We looked at filming it. It's just too complicated. When you've got orchestras and choirs and bands and heaven knows what else. The crew have got enough problems as it is to try and look at that. We're still looking at the possibility of recording it, but it means bringing in a couple of trucks and heaven knows what else. And the crew are concerned about the time, the amount of time they've got to set everything up as it is. I would love to film Blackfriars. I think Blackfriars as a film works better than, ironically, filming the Centaur. I think the Centaur would work well audio-wise because it's very much the music. Kind of. The uniqueness of Blackfriars, I think, would be well worth filming because, as I say, with the kids sort of demanding that they're allowed to say whatever they like about their dad. In fact, I know of at least four people. Two have come from Brazil and two from California, who've come specifically to hear what the kids have to say. They couldn't actually care about what I actually play. So that I would like to film, and we're still working on the possibilities of that.
And studio albums, anything current, anything coming up that people can look out for?
Yeah, there's a few things that are interesting coming up. We are next year doing a massive tour of the new Journey to the Centre of the Earth, which is a mixture of is an extended version of Journey to the Centre of the Earth with a huge Roger Dean stage. I think we're at the Albert Hall on the 28th of April, and it travels all over Europe and then all around the world. That's one of the reasons why there's no other shows or things this year right up till then, because that's going to take all of our time rehearsing and putting it together. It's a mammoth production that we're doing. So the album, which we recorded last year, a studio version in Abbey Road of Journey, the extended version, that I would imagine will come out probably around about September, maybe August, to tie in with when the tour actually starts. But that's the reason why this year, it has the big cut-off after Gloucester, because there's just so much work involved with that. And in between that, I'm still having great fun doing Watchdog, having a rant every week about whatever it is they give me to rant about. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's really quite good because you get people come up to you and say, "Oh, you smile," rather than rant all the time. So that's really good. So I enjoy all of that.
Because I think perhaps, Rick, you've had a long and amazingly successful career as a musician.
You mean I'm old?
Well, I wouldn't say that, Rick.
You did earlier.
Older than some people, but younger than others. But for people who are perhaps a little younger than you and myself. They may know you more as a TV presenter than for your music.
It is interesting that you get a lot of... I'm doing the Edinburgh Festival this year, which is like half stand-up and half music at the Assembly Rooms. And I've never done the Edinburgh Festival before. But it's one of those things you want to tick off. And it's, in the same place, 12 shows, 12 days, at the Assembly Rooms. But I was really, because of it's the whole comedy setup, which I suppose started was a mixture of live at Jongleurs, which I did for 8 years on ITV, and then I suppose a lot of the anecdotes and stuff I do in the one man shows, and it's quite interesting. I do a lot of corporate and after dinner stuff, which is great fun to do. But the interesting thing is, it's all because it shows the power of TV, because it's all because of Countdown, and Never Mind the Buzzcocks, I Got News for You, all the programs that and Watchdog. They say, "Oh, you're coming on to," I say, "Oh, do you want to play the piano?" "Well, if you want to."
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really is interesting. There's two.
Do you find that your enthusiasm, perhaps for music, would wax and wane, and the presenting and books and things like that takes over? Or
no, I mean,
first and foremost, no. Are you a musician or
whatever
TV?
I'm doing on the day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I'm in the middle of writing another grumpy book or whatever, that's what I'm doing for the day, and that's what I thoroughly enjoy. If it's music, that's what I thoroughly enjoy. If I'm doing a court event, I'll thoroughly enjoy it. If I'm doing a TV or Watchdog filming, then it's great. I love the diversity of everything. It comes sometimes a bit strange when you suddenly realise that to some people you're not a musician anymore. That is a bit weird or right. And then there's two examples I can give of that. One is Tim Rice, my dear friend Sir Tim Rice. We had dinner a few years ago. Well, it was lunch actually in London, and he's the most mild-mannered guy. I mean, and when you consider the billions of sales that he's had with the musical things around the world, and we were at this little Italian restaurant to it, and he said, I said, "How are you?" He said, "I've just had the most bizarre experience." He said, "I actually spoke back to an elderly lady," which I've never done before. He said, "I just always smile." And I said, "Well," he said, "well, I had a bit of a morning off." He said, "I was walking along," he said, "and I had this couple say to me, saw you on Countdown. Very good, lovely on Countdown." And he went, "Yes, yeah, good." And it always happens if you're on a Countdown the week before, you have a whole week of everybody talking to you about Countdown. And then he said, I went into a shop and the woman goes, "Oh, saw you on Countdown." And right. And he said, "No, the third one. Oh, saw your Countdown all last week." That was really. Lovely elderly lady came. She said, "Oh," she said, "now I saw you on Countdown. Now can I ask you a question?" He said, "What?" She said, "Now I want to ask you about Richard Whiteley and Carol and their friendly relationship." And Tim said, "I said, excuse me." He said, "Did you know I wrote Vita, Jesus Christ Superstar, Chess, and not?" And she went, "Yeah, yes. Now, do Carol and Richard, do their families, do they meet together?" And he said, I suddenly sat there and stood there and thought, I'm going to be on my gravestone famous for being on Countdown. And we laugh and we talk about the power of television. It is so, 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 so powerful. But, you know, it's not, I love doing TV. Absolutely enjoy it immensely. In the same way, I enjoy immensely walking on stage and playing. I class myself as incredibly fortunate that almost every day when I wake up, it's different. It's going to be a different day,
mm-hmm.
and I like that.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel, or how would it sit if perhaps somebody was to suggest that you'd fallen into that category of a national treasure?
I think there's a few people who like to bury me. there's a few worrying expressions actually. National treasure. That was the other one, legend. I had one guy, it was really funny, it was in an interview, and he said, I'm here with it. I said, "No, not legend." He said, it was in South America, Argentina. He said, no, you are legend." I said, no, I'm not a legend. He said, "Please, let me explain." He said, "When you are young and you are starting and you're playing and we notice you, you are Rick." He said, "Then when you get much older, you are Rick Wakeman." He said, "Then when you get in your 50, you are Mr. Wakeman." He said, "And then when you get your age, you're legend."